Welcome to the ECD virtual panel. I am really excited right now, as you can see. I also tuned my home office here into something which looks a little bit more like an event. Maybe some words around the ECD. Today we are looking back at a very successful ECD virtual week with over 20 different webinars, and we have had altogether over 1,000 participants and way above 200 one-on-one meetings in our kind of beloved meeting lounge. So firstly, I'd like to thank all of the participants for joining in, and of course, anyone who helped to make this virtual event come true. And so the same counts for you, because now it's the time to enter the panel together with you. Vanessa from Marco Polo, hello. Andreas.
Hello.
From Zalando. Andreas from VF. Still rocking with
Twitter. Hello, guys.
Thanks a lot that you're supporting our idea of a fireside chat. Kind of, I think it's an ultimate closeout for our virtual week. And this year, the ECD claim is D2C is the key. And we took this one actually also as a starting point for our discussion we are now entering. And maybe once more, D2C, from my perspective, is a little bit about transformation of brands, transformation of industry into something what is coming maybe from the wholesale area, more entering a consumer-focused one. And above all, of course, it's a topic how to deal with different platform players from a vendor perspective. And actually, we asked every one of you guys, I asked you upfront how to possibly complete the sentence, D2C is the key to. And now let's do it in a real talk show. I will firstly quote your statement and then ask you to introduce yourself quickly. And maybe you have some more thoughts around your statement. So, of course, we will start with Vanessa. Your statement around D2C is the key to is D2C is the key to further drive growth and profit if it is managed. So this was a nice one. So maybe you can shortly introduce yourself.
Yeah, perfect. Thank you, Matthias. Yeah, very happy to be here. I'm Vanessa. I'm the director of e-commerce for Marco Polo. I'm with Marco Polo for 5 years and a little bit longer in the digital world. And I was very keen to be here today. And yeah, coming to my statement, growth and profitability are the two things that are very important. And I put it on if it's managed. And I think that's very important to say, because on one side, platforms help us basically to offer the products, in this case Marco Polo, to new customers and to different customers across different international markets. This helps us to drive sales and to be a growth engine. But on the second part, it's very important basically to look at the little details of the aspect of discount levels, of return rates, and also of commissions. And this needs to be monitored in order to be profitable in the end of the day. And overall, it's also about the own e-commerce, like own web shops that are operated in different companies and countries. Yeah, where it's keen basically to look more at the customer and engage with them to build on customer lifetime value. So again, driving profitability.
Okay, great. Thank you so much. I continue with Andreas from Zalando, who said around this area, D2C is the key to a comprehensive sales channel mix. So maybe you can tell something more about that.
Hi, thank you, Matthias. Very well read. Thank you very much for inviting me again. I'm looking after the men's category at Zalando. And I've been at an ECD already 2 years ago. That was exactly the time where Zalando actually approached me if I wouldn't want to actually be working in Berlin or for Zalando. Because before that, I've been working for two major suppliers of Zalando, one being the Adidas Group and one being with brands like Tommy Hilfiger and Calvin Klein, as you can see somehow, I guess. And I believe, and that was also the story 2 years ago, but I didn't really have the visibility from a retailer perspective as much as I did from a brand perspective those times, that partner models are going to be the new normal. And I think if you look at the current situation, and I don't want to distract us all with COVID-19 and whatever, but there's currently a high tendency to speed up that evolution of buying and selling, if you will, with only one focus, which is the consumer. And hence, I'm very happy to now be part of this round here today.
Thank you so much, Andreas. I think we will pick up the topic later on. Andreas from EF. D2C is the key to better build meaningful relationships and impact with our customers. So happy to have you here, Andreas.
Thank you for that, Matthias, and thanks for having me. I'm from Sweden. Been working for VF Corporation now for, I think, soon to be 11 years. And I come traditionally from quite a wholesale background, but being passionate about key account management and working with many brands in our portfolio, North Face being one, Vans being another. As late as 2 years ago, I started to join kind of the group level position, where ultimately my role is to enable our brands to be successful on digital platforms and the digital transformation. So this is what I do in terms of better build meaningful relationship with our customers. We really look into how do we go beyond merchandise and transaction. And how do we build long-lasting relationship with our consumers, where ultimately merchandise and transaction is a product out of the relationship and the brand affinity that we build. So we really look into retention and loyalty and all that. Hence why DTC for us is absolutely key to build better purpose-led business and better purpose-led interaction with our customers, resulting in obviously meaningful sales channel when it comes to transaction and merchandising.
Okay, very interesting. Yeah, maybe I don't know if you want to join in right away, because I mean it's pretty interesting, Andreas, that you used to work on the kind of wholesale side and now you switch sides. I don't know if it had been at VF kind of this enemy thing, yeah, between wholesale and e-commerce and so on, because coming from the days where you maybe firstly introduced your brand shop. Then we talked, we had a kind of period from my perspective where we talked about marketplace opportunities, and now it's actually the impact for the whole wholesale area due to the transformation. And so how do you look at it? And how does maybe also your wholesale experience coming from that area help you when now dealing overall with this digital aspect?
Good question, right? I think in the likes of our companies and others, that kind of transition from being wholesale led to retail led is indeed a larger exercise. And I think mostly from a culture perspective and where we come from and how we do business, I think we're transitioning from going 10 years back. We had one key account manager managing one brand at Zalando, for example, to build a holistic cross-functional teams to operate our business end to end. I think that's a very different way of working, where we currently are looking into how we transform being able to take that end-to-end responsibility within wholesale and ultimately also doing that within platform capabilities that we have. So I think we need to extend the capabilities that we have within our e-com and direct channels into the wholesale channel. So you're going to see less of a Chinese wall between those areas, and looking at how we are developing an integrated execution across all the channels. I think that's ultimately the biggest challenge that we have and what we're working towards. But it's small steps forward. I think within wholesale, we already a couple of years back started to look at how we vertically approach also wholesale. So even within channels that we're considering wholesale today, we're more forward looking at how we vertically execute from a merchandising perspective, from a marketing perspective, even within that. So I think they are very much coming closer to each other. And I do believe that the fundamental driver is to be consumer minded. And I think that's the accelerator within the wholesale right now, all from 15 years back when we started to receive our first sellout data, to really try to understand sellout data, to understand what our customers are doing. And the better we do that also within wholesale, I think the better growth and the better relevancy we're able to drive with our customers. So I think it's a natural progression, is that what I'm trying to say. But from a cultural perspective, from an organization perspective, and from a process and tools perspective, there's a large progression right now across VF, but also across other companies, I guess.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, maybe Vanessa, on your side, if we talk about this consumer experience, I mean, it could be, it's just a theory that as long as you just, you know, roll out your article assortments, your offerings in a way to different platforms, it could be that your kind of brand awareness will be rather hurt because of, you know, being one part of the article listing between many others. So I think Marco Polo has a pretty much high demand from themselves, looking at the brand side, looking at the how they do merchandising overall. And what is your perspective on transforming your high demand in terms of brand awareness into this digital world where you might be one of the many? And what maybe do you do on top of article listings or whatever to also enable this kind of brand awareness as well with the online platforms?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a good question. And it's definitely a topic where we deeply look into, because on one side, as you said, there are the platforms, and the platforms offer us reach and growth, especially in the international markets and especially with fields where we are not that known maybe. And on the other side, we have the own e-commerce, the own online shops now in 22 markets, where we have a lot of markets. They have still very little, and where we see that we also will benefit from the reach of the platform. So what we basically do, and when you look at it, we have basically one stock pool for the e-commerce or for the online shop and the platforms. And we're very closely monitoring and understanding where's the demand of what kind of product on what kind of platforms. So we also have exclusive capsules that we say these are very to our members, the consumers that mostly shop in the direct Marco Polo offline stores or the online shops. And we also have products where we see there's high demand on platform, like multi-pack articles, for instance, where we see there's a demand and there's a consumer that's very keen on those products. So that's what we do on a merchandise level, but also on the platform level, we really try to differentiate the partners and understand what is the win-win of the partnership. For some partners in some countries, it's really building brand awareness, as you said, for instance, like becoming bigger in France, something where we look what partners can help us, and then the other way, where is our brand really needed, and is maybe the sustainability aspect is very big, and where we think we can kind of fill in the gaps that they're having in the assortment. And on the other side, we are not so much looking on just the brand and assortment, we are just looking at the international footprint that we can enable. So it's really a two-sided approach that we are going forward.
If I may quickly also ask a question, Matthias and I know each other since very long, so sometimes I'm allowed to jump in, I hope. I'm actually very curious because we're working with both of you as wholesale and partner program partners.
Yes.
I would be very interested in especially from you, Vanessa, is there any way that you can also think about connecting more stock to platforms? I mean, that's definitely something that guys like me would be asking more or less all the time. Or do you have a clear distinction between, let's say, platforms and e-com stock on the one hand, and maybe wholesale and own retail stock on the other hand? So is it possible to talk about this?
Yeah, it's definitely possible to talk about this. I think one aspect that's very important, everyone thinks always of the best solution would be to have one stock and then serving the customer that needs it at the right time, right? That's all the approach we are aiming at, and where we're also looking at the moment at legacy IT systems in order to understand how can we actually make it possible. So at the moment, we are not there yet. We have different stocks, basically. So stocks for the e-commerce and then also stock for the wholesale. And that's something we are really working on bringing it together. I think it's a future, and it's something where we see a huge benefit, because in the end of the day, we also believe that the customer decides at that point of time whether he needs the stock or not. And that's something where, yeah, we have a project going on. But nevertheless, in the meantime, we also try to have, I think Andreas used a very nice phrasing with this natural progression, to bring the teams together and to talk about it in the end. So we have still wholesale teams, and we have key account managers for, in this case, Andreas Zalando. But on the other side, we have like a marketplace team that's looking at the e-com stock and the merchandise. And when an order period happens or is about to approach, we make sure that we look at aggregated figures in order to understand trends. So we need to consider the antitrust law and the Chinese walls, but on aggregated level, it's very important to understand like the demands of each platform. Like, is there a drive for lower priced items? Are there multi-packs that are important, just as an example? And I think those are things where we can share our insights and try to grow wholesale on one side, but also on the other side, to make sure that things that are not bought are available on the marketplace and that we serve for them. So that's kind of our current interim solution, where we are not having one stock yet, but where we try to align in this natural way on the gaps.
Yeah, great. Maybe looking at this different kind of opportunities once more, I don't know if it's whether a question for Andreas or Vanessa, but what would be really of interest is, how do you deal with it, with this kind of new opportunities in terms of changes for your company? Because I think we came from times where, you know, the online sales just had been an additional sales channels just to make some more revenue or GMV. You know how you take it. And now I think the successful players are really converting this into a really change in the company. Also, for example, with you on the assortment planning, for example, I always put the example of the kind of outlet kind of trend coming up in the 90s. I think in the first row, it was kind of, okay, I get rid of overstock. And the second row, it was really, oh, there's traffic, there's additional demand. Yeah. And then how do I size my brand and the assortment availability into it? And maybe then I have an outlet collection or anything else. So I think in the digital area, we have this as well. So the great demand actually to rethink the business model overall, and also to rethink the one or the other behavior we used to have. And also to, for example, with looking at the NOS share or with other areas, just to be creative and just to see it really more like a digital platform, in order to also kind of calculate backwards, what does it mean from a brand perspective to deal with. So I don't know if you, maybe Andreas, can say something around how did it, maybe what did you see already in terms of changes or, tunings? And...
Yeah, I think you touched on a core subject, being kind of merchandising planning and between the different channels. That is related to what we do on partner program, that was related to what we do in the connected retail opportunity and also wholesale. So how do you plan against a full platform demand and multi-channel demand from a merchandising perspective? That is a large project that we're working on right now, in terms of how we get a little bit more sophisticated looking at journey planning versus kind of channel planning from a merchandise perspective. Another point I would say is, I think specific of having Andreas here, and he knows this very well, is one of the key differentiators of, for example, Zalando platform and a VF company is, Zalando is a retailer. We are predominantly a wholesaler within Europe. So I think the key differentiator is that Zalando is expert of, for example, trading and the in-season management piece, and where we as a company potentially haven't had to be that skilled. So the key question that arised maybe 18 months ago was, how do we acquire that capability to really become that retailers on a day-to-day basis? So I think the partnership aspect to be able to evolve our capabilities and the way how we execute our brands on these platforms is to acquire what Zalando is, for example, in this case, doing very well. So with that, we said that we're going to open up a trading hub in Berlin. So we're putting actually our VF teams into Berlin, into Zalando's office, to be able to learn how to trade on a day-to-day basis and to be able to execute more of a retail-led model versus a wholesale-led model. So I think the partnership aspect on that is core, alongside as we as a company are building the new capabilities and the ways of working, of planning our business and executing business from a wholesale to a retail model on a platform like this.
Yeah, I think maybe to jump in, because my name was mentioned, it's always not so easy to figure out which Andreas is now being addressed first. VF has been a partner since more or less my first day in Zalando, and has become, if you will, the poster child of a partner development. So one very interesting aspect was that while we are discussing very often with partners problems like, for example, local P&Ls, local stock keeping, local stock ownership in terms of maybe potentially not selling. So Andreas, could you please go on mute? Then that we have with BF mainly had the discussion around how can VF, let's say, sit next to Zalando and look over the shoulder, if that makes sense, to the degree that is legally possible, and start taking over certain tasks themselves, leading up to a case where even we started talking about exchanging talent. Not only that VF is now a tenant in a Zalando building, which we can't access currently, I'm afraid, but also that we are also starting to think about exchange of talent, because there's only this one goal, as I also tried to mention in the beginning. We want to please the consumer. There's no way that we are discussing who pleases the consumer a bit more or who gets 2-3 points more of the P&L, but that we actually say we want to make sure that the consumer gets the right product at the right time, possibly through Zalando. We believe that's a good viable opportunity for the consumer, and how that actually then happens is up to the partnership to decide.
Yeah, maybe coming to this point, Andreas, in terms of transformation, I mean, the other Andreas just mentioned around changes from a brand perspective. We all know that Zalando is pretty ambitious when it comes to really increase of this partner program share to the total GMV. So what do you think, you're in a way within this category management, yeah, being responsible for everything around the men's clothing. What do you see in terms of how does the role due to the transformation change from your perspective as well?
That's a tricky one. I think if we are really honest, and I know that also some of our Zalando colleagues are watching this, but not only because of this, I'm very careful. Just remind us of the numbers that Zalando is publishing and forecasting. We aspire to have 40% at least direct to consumer in a brand language or partner program share in our language by 2023, 2024. And this is maybe even jumping a bit short, if you will. So if we just look at the data that we just achieved through a month that was very successful, April, for example, from a partner perspective, our shares are going higher already than we would have thought. And the internationalization is carrying on. So we are very hopeful that this is going to be continuing to be an evolutional process. On the other hand, if we talk this share, also the wholesale business in itself will more or less double in the next few years. There's still a lot of work for our teams to do in terms of category management for the wholesale. And next to this, finding a good, transparent and legally viable way to combine the two business models in order to actually predict the best possible consumer assortment that we can have on Zalando, and then bring that to market through various channels. We have the partner program, we have connected retail, we of course have wholesale, we can support with stuff like ZFS and so on. Don't want to make this an advertisement space now. that actually will require more and more, let's say, consulting work, if you will, from many people in our teams. And hence, calling it category management is still right. How much is it going to be, let's say, then buying and merchandising and planning and forecasting? So how is that mix going to maybe change over time? That's to be defined. But we are prepared for this, and we do have the best talent, of course, in the world in our team. So it's going to be great.
Okay. Yeah, maybe to Andreas, I think Zalando Andreas pointed out that the VF Andreas is pretty much ambitious in terms of understanding the new D2C approach. Can you tell something about kind of historically, because I think there had been times where it was different, and now you have a clear kind of defined D2C focused strategy. So what had been the major roadblocks on the way to that one?
So good question. So ultimately referring to that, we were potentially more conservative in the past versus what we are now. I think it's connected to the confidence that we build in terms of capability and being able to execute the requirements of being a true retailer and being able to do that. I think we, throughout the last couple of years, have had a very diligent and clear and precise strategy against digital acceleration and clear commitments from the entire groups of VF group perspective down to our strategies within our brands. And also aligning to our strategy, which has been a bit being more purpose-led and being purpose-led with our customers. And within that, really positioning D2C to be the vehicle for us to move forward. So I think it's a lot of things coming together at once over the last couple of years, and that makes D2C kind of the pinnacle expression and the pinnacle priority in terms of how we're going to grow our business going forward. And I really want to root it into not a transactional purpose, but a really kind of impact with the customer purpose. So with that, then the choice of the DTC is a vehicle, that's a tool to enable that purpose. So hence why we have a large acceleration in terms of building the capabilities from a tech and infrastructure point of view and architecture point of view, but also in terms of how we are making sure that we, from a front end, a merchandising marketing perspective, are servicing our customers properly and in a more retail-led way. So I think it's not one thing, it's a couple of things coming together, but I think to make it truly successful end-to-end is you need to bleed that through your ultimate pinnacle choice as a company and having all functions to align to that. Maybe in the past that was not the case, but definitely the last couple of years that have been the case, and we can only enable that level of transformation across a large company as ours if it's rooted into the building blocks of how we're going to grow as a company. So end to end, I talked about a little bit of having our finance, having our front-end merchandising, having our tech and architecture in the background, all kind of striving for the same thing, because we have to build a lot of new capabilities, and we can only be successful if we're all heading in one in the same direction together. So I don't know if that answers questions, but hopefully it gives you a little bit of perspective.
That's interesting. I think we are on a very similar journey. It's just the difference, I think, is that Marco Polo has more retail presence. So in that sense, already beginning of the 80s, retail was quite a focus. So we already have more than 100 stores and a huge franchise system as well. So we also have the retail angle to look at, because we talked a lot now about marketplace and wholesale, but what we are also seeing is, I think it's a little echo in here. I'm not sure if it's Andreas. Thank you. What we are definitely also seeing is with our own online shop and retail, and then the business we are doing on marketplace and wholesale, that we really need to have a 360-degree approach. So it's also for us coming closer together with retail operations, but also marketing strategies overall for a brand. And I think the main question is nowadays for brands, how to be meaningful, because a lot of studies shows not all brands are really meaningful to the consumer. And I think in order to become meaningful, we need to be close to consumer and consider all channels. And that's a journey I think all brands are currently on, and basically going through different phases, how to align teams, how to align strategies. And there's always one brand vision and one marketing strategy, but then often it's going in separate ways when you have different people working on things. And I think that's also our approach, bringing that more together and really finding a storyline across all channels and having the consumer in the middle of it, basically.
If I may maybe ask directly back to you, Vanessa, if you think about your journey towards being consumer-centric and kind of overcoming potentially hurdles between different channels and so on, was there a point in time where you think, okay, now we have cracked it? That was, let's say, the biggest hurdle that you had to overcome? Or are you still aware of a big hurdle that you need to overcome? And if so, what would that be?
Yeah, I think we're still on the journey. I think we corrected that from coming from all channels, we have to look really at end consumer data and understanding it. I think one of you said it at the beginning, as a wholesaler, you just look at your 4-order sellout and that's done. And now you start actually looking into in-season management and understanding what did the consumer actually buy. And I think that was a point in time already 5 years back that the company realized we need to look at this measure, not just for our direct channels, but also for the wholesale channels. So I think that was one big step, but we still have big hurdles. And Andreas from BF talked about it. I mean, it's IT and technical capabilities in the end of the day. Bringing stock data together is one thing, right? But not just stock, but also sellout data. Obviously, always to the, as you said, antitrust law rules, but really understanding what is going well, what is not going well out from an end consumer's perspective. And I mean, one thing is to have those meetings every 2 months to kind of share high-level things, but it might be much better to have on a really detailed level the data from all channels in the way you're allowed to see it. And I think that's a challenge we are still facing, and where we need technology, where we also need the change of legacy systems. And that's something that we are working on. And I think all brands and also wholesale partners still trying to solve this issue.
Yeah, maybe when it comes to the expansion, would be one more question to Vanessa from my side. So, I mean, you already have a kind of international footprint in a way, or being in many countries. How do you see the expansion from a digital perspective or from a digital opportunity view? In a way, as you can now pretty much easy enter a country and be there. Of course, you might not have this kind of brand awareness in place locally, but how easy and how successful is it from your perspective to grow via international platform channels, actually?
Yes, it's a very attractive point for us to go with a digital first strategy. To kind of really look at markets where we think there's a potential for the brand, for basically the values the brand is handing over to the end consumer. And as you correctly said, I mean, in a digital way, it's much easier and faster to kind of put the foot in the door and kind of understand house of order, is that something working with the brand? I think what's very important is, and at least we see it also from a premium approach, that you really make your choices wisely with which partner you want to go and really build a partnership on it, because you will need marketing efforts, right? You will also need branding. It's not just that you go on in one country and operate on 5 different platforms and then you say, oh, work is done, I'm there. It's rather selecting the right partner and then kind of thinking about how to make the partnership grow. Like, what are the values of the platform? What is the offer? Is a marketing plan in place? And then what Andreas from BF said, what's the right assortment? How do we do it with the merchandising approach? And I think that's also a phase for us now we are entering, because we started with the first platforms in 2015. onboarded some countries quite rapidly, also Zalando being here, but also with other partners. And I think now we want to internationalize further, but we want to make sure we are not oversaturating in the platform field, but really making sure to select the right partner and to make a strategic plan for the growth and then see how it works and what do we need to do in order to fulfill that plan.
Yeah, maybe Andreas, VF, once more, the question also following that one is maybe also, how do you look at this international part, as you are kind of, most of your brands are global brands in a way, and how did you experience this digital expansion? And maybe what is also interesting for me, I mean, as you are really major multi-brand partner or corporate, how do you manage this kind of digital opportunities? Is it rather that you think about a framework and then you reach out to the brands and they can join in if they want to? Or is it more or less a kind of top-down direction where everyone has to follow up and just has to, you know, stick to what Andreas has thought about?
I'm going to answer that question carefully, of course. It's absolutely not what Andreas think and then the brands kind of do. It's other way around. So, coming back to my introduction, we're here to enable our brands to be successful on digital platforms. So, we always do kind of bottom-up assessment in terms of what are the business opportunities from a larger digital scope, right? So, we're making sure that we're providing our brands with what is the marketplace picture in terms of where our customers are shopping, where is the current transactions, where are the biggest opportunities for engagement, etc. But in the end, VF is a core enabler to our brands, not the other way around. So I think the brands would hold all their go-to-market strategies and that we are aiming to deliver upon. So I think with that, in terms of looking at the larger digital opportunities, and if I would focus only in EMEA, I think we realized a couple of years back that we need first to build the capabilities and to be able to expand our and open up our aperture when it comes to digital. And with that, we have built a lot the current or the last 12 months in terms of architecture and tools to be able to build marketplace business onwards. I think where we are right now, we're looking at the scaling of this in terms of how we're going to be able to be present with more customers and with other platforms. Also platforms where we don't have direct kind of go-to-market relationships with, more of a pure traffic platforms. What is the role of these platforms today and what is our presence there going to look like? I think we're going through that work currently. Outside of the typical relationship of a Zalando's or an ASOS or those, there are other traffic platforms out there that we currently are assessing. So okay, that is one piece. The other piece is really, I mean, we speak about digital, right? But digital is also with our physical brick and mortar partners. It's with our JDs. It's with our shoes in the UK, it is with Office, it is with every retailer that we have a substantial e-commerce part. And we are really looking into how do we connect all these dots, right? So how do we connect the dots between our titans and within our own e-com and also with our partners .com business? And we need to look at this holistically as one channel, because we're understanding now how their consumer journeys are happening throughout these different channels and transactions. So I think we're really trying to facilitate in the now a bit more of a holistic strategy across our brands and execution across our brands within merchandising, marketing and commercial to look at one digital consumer journey versus the different channels, etc. So, and within that, it's of course maybe opportunities outside of the current partners that we have today as well.
Okay. Yeah, maybe due to the time is running by, it's a really great discussion. I'm enjoying it. I think, Andreas, you just mentioned that maybe it's, there had been already a lot of talks around the crisis, the current, but at least I would just grab out the piece of opportunities which maybe are connected to it. And then maybe Vanessa, from your side, I mean, of course, you will be someone impacted by the lockdown in a way. So what is, maybe on the other side, you will have now risks or certain risk areas, but looking at the opportunities, what have you identified now due to the current crisis going on?
Okay, yeah, definitely. I mean, there are risks and there are still threats, but there are also opportunities. I think what for us was very important to directly be in a very open and transparent communication process with our customers to inform them what's going on safety measures, hygienic measures, but also to just keep them updated on Marco Polo and the process we are going through. And that was very helpful from the beginning. In the CRM team, we are focusing always on the customer we have. So we don't look at channels and so on. But what we realized that later on, that a lot of consumers are starting becoming a little bit more omnichannel. So today we already see there are certain consumers that are shopping more offline, and there are certain that are shopping both channels. We call them hybrids. And then there are some that really prefer to shop online, at least what we see in the data. And we see that through the crisis and the communication, it started to merge. I mean, obviously there was probably a demand to get the product somehow, but it's good to see that consumers are now more willing to engage in offline and in online, and that's definitely something we learned and an opportunity we are seeing. And overall, I think it's always also an approach for understanding new customer expectations, like customer that we didn't have before. So the drive of new customers was also very important and big.
Okay. Zalando, Andreas?
Yeah, I was actually also about to ask Vanessa something. So maybe real quick before I give mm-hmm. some statement in regards to the retail perspective yeah. of Zalando. Vanessa, did you take any commercial measures very early, like thinking about, shifting offline marketing to online and so on? Was there anything, let's say, one, two things that you would mention as a highlight?
I think one of the things from commercial measures, what we saw that a lot of actually all the shops started with offers and promotions, because we all saw this dip in the mid of March that the consumers were not shopping anymore, and all the different partners reacted with promotions, like offering spring promotions like 20 or 30% off. And what we defined for ourselves is also to give already that discount, but 20% only on items that would have been anyhow produced. It was just more a messaging in that case. And what we realized by this promotion, that a lot of consumers were just attracted by the offers, but in the end of the day, bought much more in the full price segment. So we saw that this measure was very important to kind of bring the consumers back. But in the end, shopping was all over all categories. Concerning the marketing, I think we still use the channels where we saw there is traffic and there's efficiency. So that's a shift where we shifted the budgets into. But we also believe that brand communication, especially if you have new stories to tell, like in our case, it's now to really tell the consumers more about sustainability. They need to be ongoing. The same for capsule collections. They need to be on, because it's something where we want to change also the brand perception. And that's something where we believe it was also important in the crisis to communicate about. I think these were the main things, but obviously we also saw if there's a need, we needed to move stock, right? We talked at the beginning of the session about this one stock idea and the vision, but if you don't have it yet, especially not physically, we also looked at certain stock areas from the retail stores or stock in our central warehouse that we had to move to the e-commerce to fulfill then the demand. So these were also measures that they needed to take. Not for the own shop, but also for all the platforms we are serving, where we actually took the same principles, like going with the introducing discounts and communicating strongly about the brand.
Ah, that's very interesting. There's so many things I could tell about Zalando, which has been very intense the last 10 weeks. I think maybe first of all, we also made sure, just like Vanessa mentioned, that we ensure the safety of employees. And also customers, of course, and then also figure out customer demand and behavior, and then try and ensure doing good for the industry, because there's no way that Zalando is going to be a successful either wholesale or partner program platform if we do not have strong brands that continue working with us and supplying and giving, let's say, joy to the consumer. So we try to figure out, okay, what assortment is going to be required? How can we get the assortment in? Where are other assortment opportunities? So everybody's heard about the Connected Retail Initiative, which became a massive one, where we had certain days we were up to 10% of the German revenue coming from retail stores all of a sudden. And in very early days of this initiative started, we had quite regularly 6% market share of retail stores of Zalando Germany. And if you think about the volume that Zalando can do on a day, that can be quite massive also for a regular retailer who's potentially not really a kind of, I wouldn't say not allowed to be in the shop, but actually who's not really having a full staff in the shop in order to package the goods. So many, many things that have worked. One thing that I find always striking, since I've changed sides from the brand into the retail, we created an internal view very early to understand, okay, which are the brands that have been able to acquire customers more after the COVID kind of lockdown happened than before. And then we tried to figure out, okay, what are the stories of those brands and what can we learn from it and what can maybe also other brands learn from it? And then we tried, without actually mentioning those partners, try and figure out, okay, together with intense partnerships like Andreas, for example, where we have weekly calls now with the whole brand team. Hey, is there anything that you can do? Like, for example, some brands went immediately in, took away all the offline marketing activation. Sorry for the colleagues who didn't get that budget, but then shifted it into, I don't know, Insta or whatever. Have been able to kind of heat up the brand. And all of a sudden, we had even after 13th of March, triple digit growth rates on certain brands on Zalando. Yes, of course, it was also not necessarily a wedding suit or so that the people have been buying. But if you combine, let's say, the comfy clothes that people were looking for with a very smart activation, it can work. And it really works also full price. So also there, no problem. So this is the stuff that I think I really enjoy doing. And that's also what I want to encourage everyone thinking about direct-to-consumer, the wealth of data that you can get and the kind of benchmarking and the decisions that you can derive from this and maybe the inspiration for all the teams, for product and also for channel management is really, really cool.
Very, very nice. And very interesting, by the way. I think we have to come to an end. Unfortunately, but actually we can discuss 2 more hours. maybe I clearly say thanks Vanessa and both Andreas's once more for joining on, for contributing to this talk. I think now it's a great opportunity overall. I think D2C itself stands for a pretty good kind of transformation moment for the industry side, and of course due to the current situation we are in, we are facing also on our side increase demand and try to make things to let it come true. Maybe also all of you who joined in now in the stream or maybe later on, thanks for listening and watching. Hopefully you enjoyed our little fireside chat. And last but not least, I hope to see you guys and all of you who joined in, maybe in Munich again, as we unfortunately had to move this ECD big event to October the 13th. So save the date, please. Like to see you there. And hopefully we have it in person at that time. And otherwise, good news is, looking at the past hour, I'm pretty confident that we will make it anyway, somehow. So from my side, have a great day. Stay happy, stay healthy, and thank you so much. We'll be right back.